thing. But let me just read a few verses and 20. And the 10 horns that were in his head, and the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell, even of that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them, until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. There will be a time that we will possess the kingdom, but it won't be till the Ancient of Days comes, the Lord Jesus Christ comes to take care of the Antichrist for us. Won't be our job. Our job is definitely to watch unto prayer, because the end of all things is at hand. Therefore be ye sober and watch unto prayer, which is a scripture that Barbara uses on many of her things. And watch unto prayer, take a stand, and we overcome this beast by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Thank you, Barbara, for again being with us today at Retaking America. Appreciate all your hard work and your stamina to stay this long with us, and we'll continue to we'll continue to record today till we get all of your notes taken care of, okay?
Well, thank you.
All right, Barbara, you've got the floor.
Thank you very much. I'm going to continue today speaking about the Zionist conspiracy. There's so much information, but typical theories of a Zionist conspiracy for world domination often condemn all Jews as conspirators, and even worse, as the enemies of mankind. But any treatment of a Jewish conspiracy must take into account the ancient schism that divided Israel. In the Old Testament, this division was preceded by the apostasy of King Solomon, whose idolatry was carried on afterward by the 10 tribes of Israel, and then eventually by the southern tribes of Judah. This ancient schism has profoundly affected the subsequent history of the Jewish people, and it is the dynamic of the alleged Jewish conspiracy of the present day. There is not a Jewish conspiracy per se, for not all Jews are involved in the conspiracy, but rather it is a Zionist conspiracy. At the helm of this conspiracy are Kabbalist, Judeo-Freemasonic Jews and their various fronts, such as the Priory of Zion, B'nai B'rith, the House of Rothschild, the Illuminati, all of these fronts that I have mentioned over the last couple of days. So these terms are really interchangeable. But I want to zero in today on what happened in the Old Testament. We know that the kingdom split after Solomon, that both kingdoms were eventually taken into captivity, and that there was much animosity between the two kingdoms because of the apostasy of Solomon. But in the northern kingdom, which eventually went into captivity, the tribe of Dan seemed to have the preeminence as far as idolatry was concerned. And when Jeroboam split off from the southern, from Judah and Benjamin, he set up altars to Baal in Bethel and Dan, because he didn't want the northern tribes to go back to Jerusalem to worship in God's temple. And they basically adopted the worship of the Canaanites in those northern tribes. But the tribe of Dan was preeminent. And there is a curious prophecy in the book of Judges. If you recall, Samson was of the tribe of Dan. He was a judge of Israel. But he was very much of an apostate himself. He married a Philistine woman. And during the wedding feast, he proposed a riddle to the Philistines, which they just couldn't solve. The riddle that he gave to them was, out of the eater came forth meat, and out of the strong came forth sweetness. So on the seventh day of the wedding feast, Samson's bride prevailed upon him to reveal the meaning of the riddle. And Samson told the Philistines that he had killed the carcass of a young lion with his bare hands on the way to the Philistine country, and a swarm of bees produced, kill had attracted a swarm of bees which produced honey therein. Now, this riddle may even be a prophecy, if you want to look at it that way. The lion that Samson is referring to, the lion is the symbol of the tribe of Judah. And, of course, Samson was a judge of the tribe of Dan. And Samson's killing the lion could be a prophecy about the tribe of Dan slaying and overcoming the tribe of Judah, represented by the lion. And the honey could mean this overturning of the tribe of Judah as the messianic, the tribe that would produce the Messiah, would produce the golden age, or the new age that the Zionists covet. They actually covet the birthright of Judah, and they're going to try to counterfeit it. Now, there are many indications that the tribe of Dan will produce the Antichrist. We have an entire report on that on our website. Very, very good report. Jeremiah prophesied of this from the snorting of his horses, referring to the Antichrist, was heard from Dan. The church father Irenaeus also believed that the Antichrist would come from the tribe of Dan. In the book of Revelation, the tribe of Dan is not found among the 144,000 who are sealed as the tribulation is getting underway. All indications that the tribe of Dan is in trouble with God. And if you remember Jacob's prophecy about his son Dan, he said, Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse's heels. And as that, the rider shall fall backward. And if you consider the book of Revelation, chapter 12, it speaks about the dragon who stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered. And, of course, this woman, you can tell from the context of the verse that the woman refers to Israel. But the dragon is often referred to as the serpent. In this case, it's the devil, but it is also the symbol of the tribe of Dan. And the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, and that they should feed there 1,260 days, which is the last half of the tribulation period. God is protecting his remnant of Jews. Now, I'd like to speak about the differences between the synagogue of Satan and the remnant of Israel. So no one possibly construes that when I refer to a Zionist conspiracy that I'm referring to all Jews. In the book of Revelation, in his message to the church at Smyrna, the Lord Jesus Christ referred to a synagogue of Satan as them which say they are Jews and are not. In other words, there was a synagogue of Israelites that was not Jewish. And this synagogue is still in existence. It was in existence at the time of Christ. It is an occult power elite which have rejected Jesus Christ as the Messiah of Israel. The synagogue of Satan conspires to substitute another Messiah who is made in the image of their master, Satan, and to establish a world kingdom under Satan. They claim Jewish descent, but they do not fit God's definition of a Jew, either in the Old or the New Testament. They have contempt not only for Jesus Christ, his church, and the Gentile masses, but for the Jewish remnant who are Torah observant and anti-Zionist. And yes, not all Jews are for the Zionist movement that is taking place right now. This remnant is awaiting the kingdom of Israel to be restored when the Messiah appears, and not before, when the Lord Jesus Christ reveals himself to his people, and at that time he gathers the remnant of Israel from all of the corners of the earth. Now this synagogue of Satan, in contrast, conspires to eliminate all people, whether Jew or Gentile, who stand in the way of their world kingdom. And as I said yesterday and the day before, they have developed a mind-boggling number of fronts. They have created blinds and diversions to obscure the fact that they are Kabbalist Jews with an Antichrist agenda. By means of false identities, they have infiltrated the Gentile institutions where they act as undercover agents. There they form a fifth column, and they move those institutions in the direction of the Zionist agenda. They function as agents provocateurs. They provoke violence, they beget scandals, and they do all of this to give a bad name within Christendom to Jesus Christ and his church. We talked about the false conversions. These false conversions not only were occurring within Christianity, within the Roman Catholic Church, and today we even see them in evangelical Christianity, but in the Middle Ages they converted to Islam. And there they sought to discredit the Muslims, as we're seeing today with Islam. But I will get into that a little later in this discussion. They operate as crypto-Jews. They're secret. They don't reveal their Jewish identity. But they rise to power in government and religion. They did that in the Roman Catholic Church. They did it in the Reformation. They also start new religions or religious movements. And in the course of our research, we discovered that the Seventh-day Adventists and the Jehovah's Witnesses, which were started by Charles Taze Russell, who is a Jew, was a Jew. The Church of Jesus Christ and the Latter-day Saints, the Mormons, were started also by a Jew, Joseph Smith, and he surrounded himself with a group of Kabbalist Jews who called themselves the Apostles. And of course, if you look at the Mormon religion, the Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventists, these are all very Judaized forms of Christianity. They're not Christianity, but they claim to be so. We have found that many of the parachurch organizations today are very Judaized forms of Christianity, and in some instances we've even found that their founders are crypto-Jews who claim to have had Christian conversions to Christianity. But by the doctrine that they teach, you really can't believe it, that they are Christians, but rather you have to go by their doctrine to determine who what they really are. These crypto-Jews have found their way into government, finance, education, of the military, science, entertainment, and religion. And in each of these establishments, they collaborate with other secret Zionists to advance the Zionist agenda. Now, I would like to go through a chronology of the Zionist movement because many people think it's just a modern invention, started with the World Zionist Congress 100 years ago. But this is not the case, and I would like to show that it actually started at the time of Solomon. It was very strong at the time of Christ with the Pharisees. We talked about Solomon and his apostasy. Yesterday we talked about Ezekiel 8, where after Solomon died and the Babylonian captivity began, There were the elders of Israel in the temple, even in the Holy of Holies.